Good afternoon all. Today's class is cestodes, which are flatworms. I've been asked to focus on cysticercosis and hydatid cyst. Okay. I have a lot of slides, but I'll be focusing mostly on cysticercosis. Hydatid cyst, I believe, will be covered in surgery as well. So it'll be a short topic. I'll be skipping all the surgery parts. So introduction to cestodes, you've had a class on nematodes already. You know that nematodes are round worms. Cestodes are flat segmented worms, okay? And these are parasites which parasitize the intestinal tract of vertebrate animals, okay? So the primary hosts are vertebrates. They can also infect invertebrates. So usually the cycle that happens is the primary host has the parasite in its intestinal tract. It sheds the eggs through which are excreted through its feces. These eggs are ingested by the intermediate host, which are usually pigs or cows or sheep. In these intermediate hosts, the parasite converts into a cystic larval form, which then disseminates to various tissues in the intermediate hosts, and it settles down there. These are ingested again by the primary host in the form of meat. Okay. So this is usually how these parasites are propagated. Microbiology wise, they are flat segmented tapeworms of varying lengths. They are hermaphrodites. Both male and female sexual organs are present in the same organism. The tapeworms itself are comprised of three parts. The head or the scolex, which attaches to the primary host either through hooks or grooves, longitudinal grooves or suckers. Then there are symmetrical segments, also known as proglottids, which contain the male and female reproductive organs. Then the covering over the entire body, which is called the tegument. This tegument is the medium through which the nutrients pass into the parasite. Okay, so the nutrients, they don't have a digestive tract. The nutrients are directly absorbed through the tegument through active transport. But the tapeworms don't cause such serious symptoms. Most of the serious symptoms are caused by larval forms, which are called as encysted larval forms, which are called as cysticerci. So I'll be talking about two conditions today. One is cysticercosis, which is caused by larval forms of the Tinea solium, and another one is hydatid cyst. So coming to cysticercosis, that's your Tinea solium tapeworm. These are hooks or suckers which are present on the scolex. This is your scolex. There's a small neck, and these are all your proglottids. These are the subheadings broadly that I'll be talking about. Epidemiology, pathogenesis, clinical features, diagnosis, treatment. Diagnosis and treatment both are part of management. So if you get asked a question on management, remember to talk about diagnosis also. And lastly, preventive measures. So epidemiology, the causative organism is the larval form of poke tapeworm, which is called Tinea solium. Okay, the disease is prevalent in low-income countries where the hygiene is not very good. The mode of transmission is through intake of contaminated food or through asymptomatic household carriers who have the infection, who handle the food which is eaten by the patients. Or through auto-infection itself, in case the hands are contaminated, the patient does not wash his hands properly, then there is a chance of getting auto-infected through his own hands. Okay. This is the picture. I wanted to show you the pigs, but unintendedly, this person who's sitting looks like he's squatting for defecation. Mode of transmission is through infection or is through contamination of the hands through contact with defecation, okay, through contact with stools passed through infected carriers. So this disease, once it spreads into the society, has very high epidemiological stability. Okay, it's difficult to eradicate. This is because of two reasons. One is that the cyst wall itself is highly stable. It is not susceptible to antibody reactions which are generated by the patient. Another reason is one parasite itself is capable of transmitting the infection to countless number of carriers, okay, just through contamination, just through handling of food. So these are the two reasons why the disease is highly epidemiologically stable. Coming next to the pathogenesis, the eggs which are passed through the stools come in contact with the primary host. Okay, these eggs, once they are ingested, release the embryo or the oncosphere once they reach the stomach and small intestine. These embryos or oncospheres invade into the intestinal, from the lumen they invade into the intestinal wall. From there they progress to the vasculature, the blood vessels. Through the blood vessels they are carried to different host tissues. Okay, in these host tissues they transform into metacystoids. These metacystoids later mature into cyst cervix. Okay, so the larval cysts should normally be eliminated by the immune system, but in some tissues they are not eliminated. The immune system is unable to act on the cysts, as a result of which the disease propagates and grows in these target tissues. So these target tissues are CNS, eyes, heart, and striated muscles. So this diagram, the point of this diagram is to show you the difference between teniasis, which is presence of tapeworm within the gastrointestinal tract, and cysticercosis, which is presence of the larval forms within various tissues inside the body. Okay, so this is the primary host. The primary host is having a tapeworm within the digestive tract. Through the digestive tract, the gravid proglottids are excreted through stools. These stools are normally ingested by the secondary host, that is the pig, and this pig stores the larval forms in the form of cysticercae, which are later ingested by the humans when the human takes a meal in the form of pork or beef, and then the parasite again becomes a tapeworm. So that is the sequence of events when you're talking about your teniasis. But in the case of cysticercosis, these gravid eggs, gravid proglottids, which are excreted through the feces, are again ingested by another human host. Okay, so when they are ingested, they turn into oncospheres, which are transported to various host tissues. Within these host tissues, they transform into cysticercae and cause a infection, which is called cysticercosis. So that's the difference between teniasis and cysticercosis. So the cysts, anatomy wise, they are 1 centimeter in diameter. They are comprised of 3 parts. One is the scolex, which is invaginated into the vesicle, which contains a clear fluid. This vesicle is covered by a capsule. This capsule is formed by immune reaction, formed by immune elements which are produced by the host. Okay. Within the CNS, these vesicles can remain viable and remain active for a number of years. When the cyst dies, the process is called as involution. So this is the anatomy of the cysts. The cysts are classified into 4 stages depending on what's happening. The first stage is the vesicular stage, then you have the colloidal stage, third you have the granular stage, and finally you have the calcified nodule. So the initial stage or the active stage is called the vesicular stage. In the vesicular stage, you will see the clear vesicular fluid, and you can also see this see the scolex of the parasite. This stage does not produce much of an immune reaction. Once it transforms into this into the colloidal stage, the vesicular fluid becomes more opaque. Okay, your scolex is still present, but the vesicular fluid becomes more opaque. At this point, the host generates an immune reaction to the parasite. Okay, at this point, if it's present in the brain tissue, you can see cerebral edema, perilesional edema surrounding the colloid or the parasite. After some time, the immune reaction starts to go down. Your cerebral edema starts to subside, your scolex also starts to disappear, and you start seeing calcification within the cyst. This is called as granular stage. Okay. Finally, in the 4th stage, you can see only the calcified cyst. Now it's called the calcified nodule. At this point, there is no scolex, there is also no perilesional edema. So these are the 4 stages in which your cysticercae can be present in your host tissues. I have showed you the brain because this is the CT of the brain, but in all your tissues, these are the 4 stages. So this is the same thing again. Clinical features, you can have various presentations depending on 3 factors, your cyst factors, your host immune response, and the location of your cyst. Okay, so cyst factors depends on the size of the cyst. The larger the cyst, the greater the presentation, the more severe the presentation, greater the number of cysts, the more severe your presentation, and the stage. Like I said, your vesicular stage and the colloidal stage are more or less active stages. Later, your granular stage and the calcified nodule stage are very inactive. They don't even present with any symptoms. Your host immune response, it depends on the immune status of the host. If the patient is a diabetic, or if the patient is very elderly, or if the patient is on immunosuppressant drugs, or if the patient is having HIV or AIDS, your immune response itself may be suppressed. So in that case, they may not have classical symptoms. Then coming to your location, depending on the location, if your parasite is present in the brain, patient will have neurocysticercosis. If it's present in the eyes, patient can have ophthalmic cysticercosis. Patient can also have extraneural cysticercosis in the form of subcutaneous nodules. Okay. Within the brain, again, you can have either parenchymal cysticercosis within the functional brain tissue, or extraparenchymal cysticercosis when your cysticercae are present in other remaining CNS locations, not just the brain, not the brain parenchyma. For example, your meninges or your spinal cord or subarachnoid space. Okay, so your parenchymal cysticercosis is a more or less stable disease. The symptoms, patient can present with seizures, but it doesn't get much worse than that. Extraparenchymal disease usually has a much worse prognosis. Okay, one thing, your presentation, there is more heterogeneity in the presentation. Also, your parasite load is much greater within the extraparenchymal space. Also, there is unrestricted growth of the cysticercae within the extraparenchymal space. This is why your extraparenchymal neurocysticercosis has a more severe presentation than just parenchymal. So coming to the symptoms per se, you can have neurocysticercosis. 70% patients will present with generalized tonic-clonic seizures. Okay? Patient can also have features of hydrocephalus. Patient will have headache. Patient can have blurring of vision. Patient can have vomitings because of raised intracranial tension. The cause for hydrocephalus, three explanations have been given. One is because of the immune response of the of the host itself, which will cause cerebral edema. Another is when you have extraparenchymal cysticercosis. Okay, you can have arachnoiditis, which results in a blockade of the CSF flow, which results in hydrocephalus. A third cause is presence of your cysticercae within the ventricles itself. So these can also cause blockade and result in hydrocephalus. So these are the three causes. Another feature is altered sensorium. It can be because of the hydrocephalus itself, or it can be because of cysticercal encephalitis. When your cysticercal load is very, very high, the patient can have cysticercal encephalitis. This causes altered sensory. Another presentation is various cranial nerve palsies, visual field defects. Patient can also present with stroke. Causes for stroke, because of your immune response itself, immune response of the host itself, the patient can have vasculitis picture, resulting in stroke-like symptoms. Another thing is, because of the pressure effect exerted by the cysticercae within the brain tissue, there can be compression of the blood vessels of the brain, resulting in a stroke. Okay? Rarely, when you have cysticercae within the posterior fossa, these cysticercae can descend into the spinal column. Okay, and they can cause spinal neurocysticercosis. This presents with your spinal symptoms like paraparesis, quadriparesis, spasticity, bowel and bladder dysfunction, sensory disturbances. Okay, so these are features of neurocysticercosis. Depending on location, you can also have ophthalmic neurocysticercosis. It can manifest as a cyst itself. There can also be visual field defects. Patient can also have uveitis or retinitis. Then finally, you have extraneural cysticercosis. Patient will have non-tender subcutaneous nodules, which are palpable, or discrete swellings. So this is your conjunctival ophthalmic cysticercosis. This is your subcutaneous nodules, your extraneural cysticercosis. So your clinical features are done. Diagnosis can be done based on your history, either history of intake of beef or pork. Pork, actually, because neurocysticercosis comes from pork tapeworm. So you can gather from the history. You can also, diagnosis is by imaging and serological study. So imaging is your mainstay of diagnosis. So CT is the preferred mode of diagnosis. When you do a plain or a contrast CT, depending on the number of cysticerci within the brain parenchymal tissue, you have something that is classically described as a starry sky appearance. Okay, so depending on the stage of the cysticerci, you can have various presentations even on CT. Viable cysts are seen as round and hypodense lesions. Sometimes your scoliosis can be visualized on the CT. Degenerating cysts will present as contrast enhancing lesions with surrounding perilesional edema. Calcified nodules are seen clearly as calcifications on the parenchyma, on the brain parenchyma. There is no underlying, there is no surrounding edema, perilesional edema. So this is about CT. Actually, MRI is the preferred mode of diagnosis. Your cysts are much better visualized than MRI. However, your CT is a much more practical mode of diagnosis. For one thing, it's less expensive than MRI. It takes much less time. And in case your patient is having seizures continuously, it's difficult to keep him in the MRI machine for a duration of 20 to 30 minutes. So usually your first mode of diagnosis for a patient presenting with seizures, suspected cysticercosis, is CT, either plain or contrast. Contrast is better. So MRI has better accuracy, but it's used for cysts which are suspected to be in the posterior fossa or in the ventricles or in the basal system. So this is your MRI imaging of the whole body. You can have cysts anywhere, literally, either in the muscles or in the subcutaneous spaces or in the brain or in the eyes. You can't see the eyes here, but yeah. You can also see cysts. Cysts on the plain X-ray of the muscles. Especially, you'll see cigar-shaped calcified cysts when you do a radiogram. I don't think these are X-rays. I think they are MRIs. I just wanted to show you the cigar-shaped calcified nodules. Okay? So, your imaging consists of CT, MRI, and X-ray. Now coming to your immunological assays, three have been described. The first one is the most specific and highly sensitive. It's called lentil-active purified glycoprotein enzyme-linked electroimmunotransfer blood assay. Okay, so this can be done either on serum samples or on CSF samples. It's highly specific and sensitive. Only disadvantage is that it's done on the serum or the CSF. So you can't really localize the presence of the cysts. You can't say whether the cysts are present in the muscles or in the eyes or in the parenchyma or extra parenchymal tissue. So your localization is difficult. Two more assays have been described. One is ELISA-based, another one is LFA, lateral flow assay. So these are your immunological assays. Thirdly, you can detect cysts on examination of the eye itself, or by the presence of palpable subcutaneous nodules, or by the presence of stool microscopy if the patient has concurrent tapeworm infestation. You can also do a CBC, patient will have eosinophilia. You can also do an IgE levels. Your IgE level will be elevated. Then your diagnosis is over. Coming to your treatment. For treatment, you require a multi-specialist team. Okay, you need an infectious disease specialist. You need a radiologist. You need a surgeon. You also need a neurologist for control of seizures. You may need a neurosurgeon if you are having cysts within the ventricular spaces. If you want to do a shunt placement. Okay, so you need a multi-specialist team first of all. Then you need antiparasitic. The two agents used are albendazole. Albendazole decreases the glucose intake. It depletes the glucose supply, which is available to the parasite, resulting in the death of the parasite. Praziquantel causes shrinkage and paralysis of the parasite by increasing the permeability of the parasite, the cyst wall, to calcium ions. So this is the mode of mechanism of action of both these drugs. Symptomatically, for seizures, you use various anti-epileptics. You can use analgesics for the, if there's any nerve compression or muscle pain. You can also use ventricular shunt placement if the patient has developed hydrocephalus. Steroids are used concurrently. Whenever you're using an antiparasitic, anti-cysticidal medication, it is always recommended that you use steroid, because when your cysticidal medication act and your cysts start to die, your fluid which is present inside the cyst is highly antigenic. Okay, so the fluid itself which extravasates into the host tissue can cause an antigenic reaction and anaphylactic shock. So steroids are used to control the anaphylactic reaction which is produced when your cysts die. Okay, finally you can do a surgical resection of the cyst. So these are the treatment modalities. I'll be talking about each separately. Cysticidal medication, the use of these is quite controversial, because I told you when the cyst dies, the fluid that extravasates can cause an anaphylactic reaction and severe symptoms. So the parasite death itself can lead to an acute inflammatory reaction in the brain. This itself can lead to seizures, cerebral edema, brainstem edema, and death. Okay. So you can use it for viable vesicular or colloidal stages of the cysts. However, if there are only single lesions, they may resolve spontaneously. Especially if the patient is asymptomatic, you may not need to use a cysticidal medication. So the medications used are albendazole in dosages of 15 to 30 milligrams per kg. This comes up to around 900 to 1800 milligrams of the drug in a 60 kilos adult. This can be given for a duration of 8 to 28 days. Okay. Praziquantel is given in doses of 100 milligrams per kg body weight. This is given in 3 divided doses, again for a duration of 15 to 30 days. But praziquantel, when it's used along with steroids, the efficacy of praziquantel decreases. Okay, so albendazole is the drug of choice. Albendazole is definitely more efficacious than praziquantel. But when you have multiple viable intraparenchymal cysts, you can use a combination of both albendazole and praziquantel. Always remember to use concurrent corticosteroids. So, anti-epileptic drugs, when you have a patient with suspected cysticercosis, with history of suspected exposure to pig feces, you have to continue the anti-epileptic drugs for as long as the patient is asymptomatic, up to 1 to 2 years after the stoppage of the seizures. Okay, so the drugs mentioned in the book are phenobarbital and carbamazepine. We also give either phenytoin or levetiracetam. In this hospital, we use phenytoin and levetiracetam. Steroids used are either injectable methylprednisolone, prednisolone, or dexamethasone. When we discharge the patient, we convert it into oral prednisolone or dexamethasone. Okay, so steroids should be started 3 days before onset of cysticidal drugs, especially if your cysticercal density is very high, or if the patient has ocular cysticercosis. Okay. So steroids should be started 3 days before starting the cysticidal drug, and it should be continued for 1 week after stopping the cysticidal drug. Okay. So the duration I mentioned for albendazole was up to 28 days, and for praziquantel was up to 30 days. So a tapering dose of steroids should be continued for at least 1 week after you stop your cysticidal medication. So when you have a very heavy parasitic load, these parasites, once they die, they produce a very severe anaphylactic host reaction. Or when you have a diffuse, poorly localized infection, better to avoid cysticidal drugs altogether and just give steroid alone. So then surgery. Surgery has been indicated when you have something called racemos NCC. When I told you about malaria, I mentioned something called rosetting and autoagglutination, which is all your parasites come together and form an adhesive unit. So this is something similar. Racemos neurocysticercosis is a feature of extraparenchymal neurocysticercosis. Okay? So there is a confluence of all your neurocysticerci, resulting in severe extraparenchymal symptoms. For this, more aggressive treatment is required. You can resort to neurosurgery in order to remove the racemose cysts. Okay. Also, when you have a hydrocephalus developing because of the cyst itself or because of the cerebral edema or arachnoiditis, patient will need a ventricular shunt placement. Ventricular cysts within the ventricles itself can need to be excised either directly via direct surgery or through neuroendoscopy. Okay, so this is surgical management. There are a few conditions where you have to avoid cysticidal drugs. One thing I told you was when you have a very high diffuse disease or a very high parasitic load. Another condition is cysticercotic encephalitis. Cysticercotic encephalitis is usually manifests when your cysticercal load is very high. So this is best treated with very high dose of steroids along with diuretics. What diuretics? You give osmotic diuretics, okay, to decrease the cerebral edema. Mannitol is used, oral glycerol is also used. Then subarachnoid neurocysticercosis, the patient is at risk of developing hydrocephalus because of cerebral edema, because of the reaction of the body, because of the reaction of the host to the dying cysticerci. Then when you have a lack of definitive diagnosis, you don't really have a CT diagnosis, you don't have an MRI diagnosis, you don't have a tissue diagnosis, you're just suspecting. So in such conditions, better to avoid cysticidal drugs. When you have a patient who is asymptomatic with only parenchymal cysts, I mentioned that parenchymal cysts have a less severe presentation. So if there are no symptoms or if the symptoms are very mild, don't give cysticidal drugs. Or if you're having stage 4 calcified lesions, don't give cysticidal drugs. When the patient is asymptomatic and your cysts are in a dormant or latent stage, don't give cysticidal drugs. Finally, coming to the prevention. Prevention can be obtained by mass administration of either albendazole or praziquantel in known endemic regions. It can also be achieved by increasing the sanitation levels. Also by educating the communities about hand washing and hygienic measures, improved pig husbandry, enforcing of meat inspection and control measures, treatment of infected animals, and finally vaccination of pigs. Okay, one vaccine called TSOL-18 has been developed, which is a recombinant vaccine developed from oncospheres of the Tinea solium oncosphere. Then differential diagnosis. This is differential diagnosis of neurocysticercosis. Okay, it can be. You can depend on the size of the cyst. You can think of metastasis. You can think of tuberculosis, biliary tuberculosis. You can think of malignancy. You can think of sarcoidosis. You can think of fungal infections, toxoplasmosis, demyelinating disorders, brain abscess, cerebral abscess. Yeah, brain tumor. Then this table just to differentiate between cysticercosis and tuberculoma, because both are seen as ring enhancing lesions on CECT. So your cysticercosis is round in shape, whereas your tuberculoma is quite irregular in shape. The cystic presentation is quite clearly seen on cysticercosis. With your scolex and the vesicle quite clearly seen, whereas your tuberculoma is seen as a solid lesion. The size of the cysticercal lesion is 20 millimeters or less, with clear ring enhancement and a visible scolex. Your tuberculoma is usually larger in size. Then cerebral edema associated with cysticercosis is not enough to produce a midline shift or any focal neurological deficit, whereas cerebral perilesional edema associated with tuberculoma is usually associated with a midline shift and focal neurological deficit. So to summarize, neurocysticercosis is one of the most is the leading preventable cause of seizures. Okay, Treatment is with antiparasitic and steroids and surgery if indicated. Then, yeah, these are your cysts. You can clearly see the scolex inside your cysts. This is your brain on autopsy. Then we have the hydatid cyst. Hydatid cyst will also be covered under surgery, so I won't be talking much. I'll just rush through. Hydatid cyst is caused by the larval stage of the dog tapeworm, also known as Echinococcus granulosis. So the same subheadings will be discussed. Coming to the epidemiology, it's caused by the larval stage of Echinococcus granulosis. These are smaller tapeworms which inhabit the small intestine of carnivores. Okay? The larval stages can accidentally accidentally infect the human and cause hydatid disease. The incidence is 1 to 200 per 100,000 population. WHO says that there are about 1 million infections per year. Okay? It's a largely underreported disease because it's largely prevalent in pastures and field areas where mostly your population is rural. So they don't really report to the hospital. Your infections are not picked up. So your numbers are quite underreported. Microbiology, it's caused by the dog tapeworm, also known as Echinococcus granulosis, predominantly seen in regions where there are large pastures or ranges. Okay? So dogs are the definitive hosts. Sheep or ungulates are your intermediate hosts. Humans are actually accidental or dead-end hosts. Okay? So most of the human infections are accounted by the G1 or G2 strain. This is your geographical distribution, go through later. Your definitive hosts are the dogs, intermediate hosts are the sheep. This cycle should actually continue between these two, but when the feces from the egg, the eggs from the feces are accidentally ingested by the humans, the eggs can become, eggs can disseminate to various tissues and result in hydatid cyst. So risk factors, people who are living in fields or working in pastures, people who are veterinary doctors or veterinary helpers with repeated exposure to dogs and their feces, uncontrolled slaughtering, poor hygienic conditions, poor environmental and water hygiene. So pathogenesis is accidental injection of the Echinococcus granulosis eggs by the humans. These eggs reach the stomach and the small intestine, and oncospheres are released into the small intestinal lumens. Okay, through the lumen, it enters into the enterohepatic circulation. It is carried into the liver. 60% of your hydatid cysts manifest in your liver. Okay, 20% of them can manifest in the lung. Other tissues which can be involved are kidney, spleen, brain, heart, and bones. Okay, so this oncosphere, once it reaches the host tissue, it differentiates into the hydatid cyst. So tissue damage is because of the pressure effect or displacement of the vital host tissue or compression of the vessels or the ducts which are in close proximity with the host tissue. This is the cause of your tissue damage. Another reason for tissue damage is accidental rupture of the cyst. So your cyst contains highly antigenic cyst liquid. Okay, so this can cause an anaphylactic reaction, and it can also cause multiple secondary cysts which are seeded to even distal tissues. So this is your histology. Three layers are formed. The innermost germinal layer is the layer which produces your brood capsules. This is a brood capsule which is formed from your germinal layer. It contains several scolices, and it's only surrounded by your germinal layer. Okay? Your cyst can also contain several daughter cysts. Okay? Daughter cysts also contain scolices, but it is lined by your germinal layer as well as your thick acellular laminated layer. Okay, Then you have your adventitious connective tissue capsule. The germinal layer and your acellular laminated layer are produced by your cyst, whereas your adventitious connective tissue layer is produced by the host response to the cyst. Okay, it's a result of host derived immune response. So efficient immune response from the host or cysticidal drugs can bring about calcification and degeneration of your cyst. So this is the histology and morphology of your cyst. Then classification of cyst is your cysts can be classified into six stages. CE1 and 2 are both active stages. CE3A and 3B are transitional stages. CE4 and CE5 are inactive stages. CE stands for cystic echinococcosis. So staging correlates with the growth of the cyst, the stage of decay of the parasite. It's important for prognostication of the disease as well as planning treatment. Okay? So these are your stages. WHO staging classifies from CE1 to 5. The Garvey staging divides it from types 1 to 5 again. Please go through this later. The CE1, usually you have a unilocular cyst. When you have come to CE2, you have a multiseptated rosette-like or honeycomb appearance. Both CE1 and 2 are active stages of the cyst. CE3A, your cyst membrane start to detach from your outermost host layer. CE3B, your cyst liquid starts to solidify. Okay, so your daughter cysts start to die. These two are transitional stages. In CE4, you have heterogeneous or hypoechoic, hyperechoic lesions. Daughter cysts are not visualized. The scoliosis which are seen inside your daughter cysts are they form a layer at the bottom of the cyst. This is called as hydrated sand or hydrated grain. Okay, this is an inactive stage. Then finally, you have CE size where your cyst has become solidified with calcification of the wall. This is also an inactive stage. Clinical features: the cysts can remain inside the tissue and stay asymptomatic for up to for either years or decades. Okay, so the presentation takes years because it grows by maybe 1 to 5 centimeters per year. So it's a very slow growing condition. Incubation period is variable. The symptoms develop either because of deformation of the host tissue or because of dysfunction of the adjacent organs or because of compression of the vasculature or ducts. Okay, 1/3 of your patients can develop pressure symptoms. So coming to the individual organs, this is a slightly busy slide, but I'll try to talk about all of them. 60 to 70% of patients will develop hepatic symptoms. Okay, hepatic hydrated cyst. It causes right abdominal pain or epigastric pain. It can also cause nausea, vomiting, jaundice because of compression of your biliary duct. Patient can have hepatomegaly by your cyst can grow up to 15 centimeters in size. Okay, so this cyst is within your liver. So on top of your liver, when you have a 15 centimeter cyst, you will have hepatomegaly. You can also have a fluid thrill. Okay, the right lobe is involved more commonly than your left lobe. The cyst size can range from 1 to 15 centimeters. Complications of hepatic cyst can be biliary or cholestatic cirrhosis and secondary bacterial infection of your cyst. Okay, so this is about your hepatic hydrated cyst. Next, coming to your lung cyst, 20% of cases can involve the lung. Okay, so patient can present with chronic cough. Patient can have hemoptysis if the cyst is invading your blood vessels. Patient can have pneumothorax if your cyst suddenly ruptures. The cyst can also rupture your pleura, resulting in a pneumothorax. Okay? Patient can have pleuritic pain. Also, patient can develop a lung abscess similar to your liver abscess if there is a secondary bacterial infection. Patient can also have a lung embolism if your parasite embolizes to the lung vasculature. Cyst rupture can occur in up to 25% of cases. This is a very serious condition. It can cause an anaphylactic reaction and also result in anaphylactic shock. Then other tissues which can get involved are your heart. Basically, it presents like a tumor, be it inside the heart or your brain or the bone. Okay, so heart can present like a slow growing tumor. Your immune reaction within the heart can produce a pericardial effusion. If the effusion becomes very high volume, the patient can also have tamponade. Patient can also have conduction defects, resulting in complete heart block and sudden death. Brain also, it presents as a slow growing tumor, and much later stages it can present with neurological symptoms. Bone, it's a very potentially devastating condition. Why? Patient can be your solid bone is replaced with a cyst. Okay, so your erythropoiesis is affected, there is dyserythropoiesis. Also, your bone becomes very susceptible to fractures. So that's about your clinical features. Coming to diagnosis, you can ask for history. You can also do an examination. Imaging, you do an ultrasound. Ultrasonography is the diagnosis, is the investigation of choice. You can also do a CT or MRI. Chest X-ray, especially if you have a lung cyst. Okay, then you can also do serology. So this is the imaging. I won't talk about all these stages again. But this is your ultrasound picture. This is your unilocular cyst. This is your honeycomb appearance or multiseptate cyst, also described to be rosette-like. This is your 3A, where your cyst starts to collapse. Your cyst wall starts to collapse. Okay, this is called as water lily sign. Then your you see your daughter cysts with solid matrix. Then your daughter cysts disappear, your matrix starts to solidify. Finally, the last diagram has disappeared, I'm sorry. Finally, you see a calcification. This is your chest X-ray. In chest X-ray, this is your chest cyst, okay? This is why I wanted to show you this X-ray, because when your cyst ruptures, there is every chance of the patient developing a pneumothorax, okay? So ultrasound is over, chest X-ray is over. You can do a CT scan if your ultrasound is quite inconclusive, especially in patients who are obese. Patients have excessive abdominal gas, which is interfering with the ultrasound imaging. CT is preferred when you have patient with inactive cyst having calcification. Also, CT is good for volumetric follow-up. Once you start the treatment, you want to follow the size of the cyst to see whether it's increasing or decreasing or the same size. So in such cases, CT can be used. MRI can be used for identifying changes either in intra or extrahepatic venous systems. ERCP can be used when there is suspected biliary obstruction. Okay, so ERCP is good because it's both a diagnostic as well as a therapeutic modality. It establishes a cystobiliary communication. This is as far as your imaging is concerned. Aspiration cytology, not recommended. Only if your imaging is very, very inconclusive, because there is the risk of cyst rupture and seeding and anaphylactic reaction. So aspiration, it's very high risk. So generally try to avoid it. Then your imaging is over. Coming to immunodiagnostic tests, you can do, you can look for antibodies. The two modalities used are indirect hemagglutination test and ELISA. So sensitivity is 85 to 98% for hepatic hydrated cyst, 50 to 60% for pulmonary. Okay. Then blood investigations, your CBC will show leukocytosis, especially if there is secondary bacterial infection. It will also show eosinophilia, because if you have an anaphylactic reaction, okay, it will also show eosinophilia. I'm sorry, your parasitic infections itself are associated with eosinophilia. So that's why. Then on LFT, you can have hypobilirubinemia. This can be either direct because of the direct compressive effect on the liver parenchyma, or indirect because of obstruction, biliary tract obstruction. You can also have raised ALP. This is also because of your biliary tract obstruction. Some patients, 30% of patients can show hypogammaglobulinemia. Then you have something called as Cassini test. Cassini test is quite obsolete. It's not done anymore because it's quite dangerous. So what is done is 0.2 ml of hydrated fluid. This is antigenically active. Okay, hydrated fluid, which is obtained from the patients, from the cysts which are drained from patients, is in 0.2 ml is injected intradermally into the skin of the suspected patient. 15 minutes later, you observe a wheel-like response on the skin of the patient. Another 20 minutes later, you'll see other wheels also. But this Cassini's test is quite obsolete because it's not done anymore. It's quite dangerous. Coming to your treatment modalities, your first line of treatment is surgery. Okay, so I'll briefly be touching on your surgical modalities. Then you can also do a percutaneous drainage. Finally, you can opt for medical management. So surgical treatment can be either conservative, radical, or laparoscopic. Conservative treatment is sterilization, partial evacuation of the cyst contents, including your hydrated membrane. Okay, so what is done is you puncture the cyst, then you have to partially aspirate the cyst content. Then you introduce the scolicidal agent into the cyst. After that, you again partially aspirate the cyst content. So this is your conservative modality of treatment. Intraoperatively, there is not much risk, but there is a high chance of cyst recurrence in about 20% of cases. And there are higher chances of complications post-operatively. Then radically, complications are anaphylaxis because of spillage of the cyst contents. Patient can also develop chemical cholangitis, especially if there is a communication with the biliary tree. They can also be seeding and secondary hydatidosis if the daughter cysts are spilled while you are draining the cyst fluid, and if this communicates with the biliary tree. They can also be secondary bacterial infection and abscess formation. So these are some of the complications. Radical procedure, you do a complete resection of the cyst with or without hepatic resection. Okay? So because this is a more complicated procedure, it's associated with a higher intraoperative risk, but your chances of recurrence are very, very low, and your post-operative complications are also quite low. So when you're doing a radical procedure, you can also give adjunctive albendazole. Okay? Albendazole is given starting 1 week before surgery and should be continued for 3 months after surgery. Okay? So this prevents secondary cystic echinococcosis, and it also prevents relapses. Okay? So you also have to protect the surgical fields by using pads which are soaked in scolicidal agents. Then your percutaneous treatment for unilocular cysts, it's an attractive alternative to either conservative or radical surgery. So something called the pair procedure is used. Okay? PFUM puncture, you have to puncture the cyst, aspirate the cyst fluid, inject the scolicidal agent into the cyst, then re-aspirate the cyst content. So this is why your percutaneous method is preferred when you have unilocular cysts. Okay, so this procedure is contraindicated when you have pulmonary cysts. Two reasons I can think of. One is your cyst, if it ruptures, you can have an anaphylactic reaction. Another thing is when you're introducing a needle into your pulmonary cyst, when you're retracting the needle, patient can accidentally develop a pneumothorax. Okay, so it's a high-risk procedure, so that's why it's contraindicated in case of pulmonary cysts. Then the cysticidal agents which are used are hypertonic saline, 95% ethanol, albendazole, as well as betadine. So your diagram, they'll be talking about this in your surgery classes again. Other percutaneous techniques described go through this later. The first one is PVAC, percutaneous evacuation, modified catheterization technique, dilatable multifunction probe. So complications of your percutaneous technique are similar to your surgical conservative as well as radical surgery, which is anaphylactic reaction, spillage of the cyst fluid and seeding, secondary echinococcosis, chemical cholangitis. Medical treatment, mebendazole was the initial agent which was used, but now albendazole is the drug of choice. Albendazole is given in doses of 10 to 15 milligrams per kg per day, given in 3 cycles of 1 month duration with 14 days of gap between each cycle. So albendazole is the drug of choice. Albendazole has better efficacy, it also has better absorption compared to mebendazole. Adverse effects of albendazole are alopecia, gastrointestinal symptoms, bone marrow suppression and aplastic anemia, elevated liver enzymes, and first trimester of pregnancy it is advised not to use. So your surgical modality is over, your percutaneous drainage is over, your medical management is over. Your fourth option is also to wait and watch. Okay, so when you have accidentally detected a cyst, the cyst is not active. When you have a consolidated cyst, which is either in stage 3B, which is either in the transitional stage, either stage 3B or in stage 4 or 5, consolidated cyst which is not active, you don't have to really intervene. Also, when you have a calcified cyst, it's also not active. You can just wait and watch. Just follow up the patient. So, yeah. This is an overview of your treatment. When you have a stage 1 cyst or a stage 3A cyst, which is less than 5 centimeters in diameter, you can treat with albendazole. More than 5 centimeters in diameter, treat with percutaneous drainage along with albendazole. Stage 2 or stage 3EB, you have to do a catheterization. Catheterization is you have to put a needle and attach a drain so that your cyst is continuously draining. So you have to catheterize along with consideration, along with surgery, along with adjunctive albendazole. Then stages 4 and 5, just wait and watch because they are inactive stages. So differential diagnosis to consider in case of hydrated cyst, biliary obstruction, cancer, primary in the liver, hepatic cysts, hypersensitivity reaction when you have a cystic rupture, intra-abdominal sepsis when you have a cyst with secondary bacterial infection, liver abscess can also be considered, portal hypertension, and teratoma. Complications, the patient can develop fistulas into adjacent organs or ducts. The most common fistulas described have been hepatopulmonary and hepatobiliary fistula. Rupturing and seeding into the peritoneal cavity, intrathoracic cavity, into neighboring viscera or vasculature. Seeding of the infection and secondary hydatidosis. Secondary infection of the cyst itself with various bacteria and sepsis. External compression resulting in portal hypertension. So your hydrated cyst has also been completed. I'll just touch on the rest of your cystodes. Teniasis have, cysticercosis and teniasis, it's the same tapeworm. Teniasis can be caused by tenia saginata, which is your beef tapeworm, or tenia solium, which is your pork tapeworm. It's a good disease. There's no religious discrimination here. It can be caused by consumption of either raw or undercooked beef or pork. So symptoms are not much. Patient can have minor abdominal discomfort, abdominal pain, flatulence, bloating, nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. Eggs which are passed through feces may cause cysticercosis. Cysticercosis we have talked about. Then you have diphyllobothriasis. Diphyllobothriasis, also called as fish tapeworm. It's the longest known tapeworm. It can have more than 1,000 proglottids and measures more than 10 meters. Okay, so it's found in these countries, Scandinavia, Russia, Brazil, Japan. It's caused by consumption of raw infected fish, just because it attaches to the intestinal lumen, and just because it occupies so much space inside the intestine because of the size of the tapeworm, patient can have nutritional deficiencies like vitamin B12 and iron deficiency, because your absorption is it interferes with the absorption of vitamin B12. Then finally you have hymenolepiasis caused by Hymenolepis nana. Your fish tapeworm is the longest known tapeworm. Hymenolepis is the shortest known tapeworm. It's also known as the dwarf tapeworm, measures only 4 centimeters. So it's carried by rodents, which are the principal animal reservoir. Heavy infection can cause diarrhea. Okay, so see your last slide. Your hydatid cyst will also be discussed under surgery, but please go back and read, because your hydatid cyst of both liver and lung can be asked. Neurocysticercosis is a very important topic. Go through my slideshow again. Also, please read your Harrison and your whatever sources available. Neurocysticercosis is important. Cysticercosis is an important topic. So that's the end of my class. Thank you for your attention. I wanted to mention that at the end of my during my malaria class, I forgot what was the ligand to which your PF EMP attaches. So the name of the ligand which is present in the blood vessel, which is present in the endothelium, is called basidin. Okay, so all this is there in your Harrison. It was a very exhaustive topic. It was a very lengthy topic. So momentarily forgot. But that's the end of your class. Thank you very much for your attention.
What do you ask, man?